Welcome to Eggs and Issues, a monthly business program presented by the Portland Community Chamber of Commerce. Hello, I'm Mike Violet from News Radio WGAN. Eggs and Issues is supported by presenting sponsors Bank of America and Martins Point Healthcare, in cooperation with Harvard Pilgrim Healthcare, Oxford Networks, and WEX. And now, please welcome the Portland Community Chamber of Commerce President, Quincy Hentzel from Industrium.
Good morning, everybody. Wow, the mayor really attracts quite a crowd. I think this might be our biggest group we've had yet. I think we're breaking somewhere around the 380 mark. So thank you all for being here. It's a pleasure to have you here today. My name is Quincy Hentzel. I am the Director of Community Outreach at Industrium, and I also serve as the volunteer president of the Portland Community Chamber of Commerce. And today we have a great event for you. We will be having an interview with Portland's newly elected mayor, Ethan Strimling. And I do know we have several current and former councilors with us today, and we may even have some state legislators here. If you are an elected official or a former elected official, would you please stand? Thank you all for joining as well. It's wonderful to have you here today. I had the chance to hear Mayor Strimling's State of the City speech on Monday night, and his message was very positive, yet it did challenge us to continue to identify and understand the problems of our city, work together, and aim for greatness for Portland. We agree that Portland's future is very bright, and the Chamber is committed to being a partner with city government as Portland grows. One of the ways that we can be a better partner is for the Chamber to communicate more clearly and to more people. How can we get better jobs? What will help reduce rents and housing costs? Where will we find the workers and the skills that are needed to grow existing employers and bring new jobs to this region? We talk about these issues often, and we even have ideas and potential solutions, but we often don't do a good job of telling voters, parents, and workers why growth and development can benefit them individually. We are committed to doing a better job communicating this in the months ahead. And in our effort to help be better communicators, we have brought Chris Quint on board, who is serving as our new City Hall liaison. And I do believe Chris is with us here this morning. There he is. Chris has an extensive communications, public relations, and strategic planning background and will help us get the word out. We will continue to represent the business community at City Hall, and we will also be a voice throughout the community, expanding the connections between a growing economy and the benefits that growth brings to the people of our city and our region. Thank you, Chris, for joining us today and for joining us at the Chamber family. It is great to have you. More fun lies ahead, for sure. So we do have a different format to today's presentation, so in the interest of time, I am just going to move right ahead. Eggs and Issues is supported every month by our generous sponsors, so I do want to take a moment to thank them for making this possible. Our presenting sponsors are Bank of America and Martins Point Healthcare. Cooperating sponsors, Harvard Pilgrim Healthcare, WEX, and Oxford Networks. Reception sponsors, Clark Insurance, KeyBank, and IDEX. Parking sponsor, Identity Group, Allen Signs with Impact. Headlight Audiovisual provides our overall production support, and Time Warner Cable's digital service Video on Demand broadcasts our program each month. The Forecaster serves as our print sponsor, MainBiz our e-media partner, and WGAN our radio sponsor. WMTW serves as our broadcast sponsor, and I'd also like to thank our special community partners, who are Anthem Blue Cross and Blue Shield, New England Cancer Specialists, the BDN, and the University of Southern Maine. AAA, oh, thank you. Applause, please, thank you. Mike's very enthusiastic this morning, thank you. AAA Northern New England and Springborn Staffing support our Tomorrow's Leaders and Entrepreneurs program, which allows students to attend Eggs and Issues every month. And today we welcome students and faculty from Cheverus, Portland and Falmouth High Schools, Maine College of Art, Southern Maine Community College, and the University of Southern Maine. Would you please stand? It's a great representation this morning. Thank you all for joining us. Baker Newman Noyes sponsors our Community Corner program, which allows us to highlight an area nonprofit every month and talk to the great things they provide our community. And today's Community Corner is the Boys and Girls Club of Southern Maine. Boys and Girls Clubs is an area youth development organization providing after-school and summer programs for children and teens with five locations in Greater Portland and Lewiston Auburn, including their flagship facility on Cumberland Ave across from Portland High, on Broadway in South Portland, and two satellite clubs in Portland's Riverton Park and Sagamore Village. Boys and Girls Clubs focus on three priority outcomes for every member that walks in their doors. They are academic success, healthy lifestyles, and good character and citizenship. In recent years, the clubs are serving more young people more often with greater impact so that every kid and teen can graduate from high school on time with a plan for the future. Boys and Girls Clubs of Southern Maine provide safe places for kids and teens to learn, have fun, and develop skills and interests that last a lifetime, and allow them to grow into responsible, productive, and caring adults. Joining us today, we have Bob Clark, CEO, and Annie Messinger, Director of Development and Marketing. We are also pleased to be joined by Gary Bergeron of Morgan Stanley, who serves as a volunteer vice president of the board. Would you all please stand and be recognized? Thank you for being here today. So on to today's presentation. Today's presentation is an interview with Mayor Ethan Strimling. A little background on Mayor Strimling before we begin. This is not his first time as an elected official. He also served in the state Senate for 6 years, representing Portland as chair of the Labor and Criminal Justice Committees while also serving on the Taxation Committee and chairing Maine's Homeland Security Task Force. Prior to becoming mayor, Mayor Strimling spent 19 years as the CEO of LearningWorks, a not-for-profit providing learning opportunities for at-risk youth, the immigrant community, and low-income families. Additionally, Mayor Strimling spent 8 years as a political analyst for the local NBC and CBS affiliates, as well as writing a column for the Maine Sunday Telegram and the Bangor Daily News. He earned a bachelor's from the University of Maine, a master's from Harvard, and attended the Juilliard School as a theater student. More to come on that in the Q&A segment. It's my pleasure to introduce to you and to invite onto the stage Mayor Ethan Strimling.
Where's Phil Harriman?
Right. We were actually going to have him do this interview.
That would not have been fun.
Thank you so much for joining us today.
Glad to be here.
And for the audience's benefit, we are going to engage in a Q&A segment for probably the next 25 minutes or so. And we do want to allow opportunity for Q&A from the audience. So we'll leave about 15 minutes at the end for that. And so you know, many of these questions that I'm going to engage in with the mayor came from you. We had actually asked for recommendations from attendees who are going to be here today at the breakfast. And so many of these have come from the audience, and the questions also reflect the chamber's priorities and goals for 2016 and beyond. So before we jump into the Q&A, I do want to allow the mayor a moment or two for, I guess, we'll call opening remarks. So if you will, you have the floor.
Okay, thanks. And thanks for having me here. I look forward to this conversation, and I really hope it is a conversation. As I've talked about a lot in my first 2 months on the job, the only way that we're going to be able to get Portland to become what we want it to become is making sure that we're having a dialogue and that all voices are at the table. As many of you know, I really appreciated your support when I ran for mayor. But what was most important about the support I was receiving is that it was across the political spectrum. So while I had the chamber support, I also had the support of a number of unions in town. We had city councilors, and we had state employees. We had school board members, and we had teachers. We had Sudanese. We had Somali. tried to build the broadest coalition possible, not simply to win an election, but because that's the way we have to govern. And so it's imperative, I think, for me at all opportunities to try to bring those voices to the table. And you obviously are a crucial part of our future. If we are going to build our economy, grow our GDP, if we're going to figure out how to push wages up and bring in even higher paying jobs, you have to be our partners at the table. And I'm going to ask you to be partners over and over again. And I hope that we can always have dialogue. We're going to find ways. I think there's going to be times when we're going to disagree. But I hope that in those moments where we disagree, we are sitting at a table, disagreeing and trying to find an answer. I talked about Phil Harriman when I first got up here. What he and I tried to do for 8 years together was simply to try to model a different kind of conversation. How can two people who disagree find a way to an answer? And that's what I hope to model my mayorality with as I'm here for the next 4 years. So thank you for having me, and I look forward to a good conversation today.
Thank you, Mayor. And so with that, I think I'm going to just channel my inner Barbara Walters.
Excellent.
And we will proceed down the path of my first official interview. And we'll start with some softballs to get warmed up.
Oh. I'll bet. You're not going to ask me about how the Knicks did against the Celtics last night, are you? Because they didn't do so well.
So, Mayor, I know you are from away. Mm. I think you were born and raised in New York City.
I was.
So I am curious, and I'm sure many in the audience are curious as well, what is it that keeps you here in Portland?
So I'm going to comment on your question. I think there are some people who have pushed back a lot on this language about from away. And I think it's important that we push back on that, because I think our city and our state get stronger as more and more people come in. So I think we always have to be thinking about our language and how we welcome. We are all immigrants to this city, whether we have been here for 30 years like I have, or whether you've been here for five generations. So I'd always ask us to be thinking about not being from away, but what keeps you here, which is what I liked about the second part of your question. What I love about the city of Portland is our diversity, our economic diversity, our ethnic diversity, our religious diversity, and the energy and the inspiration that brings. This is a city, I think, I've lived in Maine, as I said, for almost 30 years, and there's no city that I'd rather live in than this city right here, because it has that energy, because it brings something to the table that's very different than I think you see in a lot of communities. Even where I grew up in New York, if you look at our elementary schools in the city, East End, Reike, Riverton, those schools are more diverse than the schools I went to in New York City. My father comes up here, goes into Reike, and he's like, this is like the UN. It's remarkable, because even in a place like New York City, unfortunately, it can become very segregated based on neighborhoods. But here we aren't, and I love that about this. And I think that inspiration is what keeps me here.
Thank you. I appreciate your answer. I, too, am not from Portland.
Mm, excellent.
And I always felt like from away just made you feel so not from here, and you never will be.
Yeah.
So I will work alongside with you changing that language.
Excellent. Thank you.
Another question. I mentioned in your bio that you had attended Juilliard School for Theater.
Yeah.
And I am just going to assume that in your youth, you did not have your eyes set on being the mayor of Portland.
I did not.
So I'm curious, back in those days at Juilliard, what was it you wanted to be when you grew up?
I wanted to be Marlon Brando when I grew up back in those days.
Can I see your best Vito Corleone?
No. I was in the theater. I grew up in the theater. My father was an actor. My grandmother was an actress. And he did a lot of theater in New York, downtown theater. And I ended up going to the High School of Performing Arts as an acting student. And then went to Juilliard, and at the time I was really interested in being a classical actor, which means Shakespearean sort of classical theater, obviously with some modern moved in. But at age 19, I really realized it was kind of one of those moments where I think you grow up in a certain culture or grow up in a certain family, and you kind of follow the path of your family, and you're not sure if it's your choice or if it's because that's what you know. It's as if, you know, your father's a mechanic, so you become a mechanic, or your mother's a doctor, so you become a doctor. For me, I think I was becoming an actor because that's what I knew, as opposed to whether it was my choice. And so at age 19, I said, I'm going to see if this is my choice or not. I got out of New York City. I went about as far from New York City as you could imagine, to Sedgwick, Maine, where some friends of mine were living, and I lived on their farm for a year and learned how to tinker around and fix cars a little bit and bought a 63 Falcon and drove it across country, so that was fun.
Very good.
I painted it, too. Beautiful white.
Maybe I should be channeling my best James Lipton from inside
yes.
the Astor Studio,
yeah. Yeah.
if anybody watches that.
Yeah.
Sounds like many of you do not.
it's a generational thing, I think.
So let's move into some of the meat of our conversation. So the position of an elected mayor, which serves a four-year term, is still relatively new in Portland. And there have been some growing pains trying to navigate how the elected mayor works with our city manager. Both you and John Jennings, Portland's city manager, are relatively new to your post. So I'm just curious, how has it been your first 2 months? How have you been working together?
Been working very well. John Jennings is incredibly competent, and I think what that does, I was a CEO for 19 years, so I fully understand what the job of a CEO is. My job is more like being the chair of the board, and anybody who's in the private sector, you understand the difference between those roles. His job is to run the city, run it with a sense of excellence, make sure that we are achieving the expectations that the board of directors is setting, and our job is to continually look at policy and try to understand what it is, the direction that the city needs to go, and what are the tools that John needs to put into place to make it happen. So far, the two of us have been working very well together. I think having people in those jobs who really understand those roles at a high level of competency is going to bode very well for the future. I'm very pleased. I wasn't there when John was hired, but I'm very pleased that he was brought in.
Is there anything the two of you have a principal difference over?
No, not yet. I mean, he's a Celtics fan, so that's okay. But
let that slide.
Yeah.
Excellent. So the city council just had a workshop on their 2016 council priorities. I believe that was early last week. Yeah. Which priority do you think is the most important and why?
Well, you're going to make me choose because the councilors had all these. So we went through the five committees that we have. And each committee, the council put up from 12 to 20 different goals and then started prioritizing them. I know Jill, Nick, and Ed are all here, and we're all part of that conversation. It was a great session because I think it was both very specific but high level enough that we're not going to get into the sort of mishigas of the weeds. For our Economic Development Committee, we were really looking at universal broadband, obviously very important, creating an Office of New Americans, trying to make sure that the folks who are coming here are going to be able to help build our economy the way generations behind us have. On our Housing Committee, we were looking at how do we really assess the problem, take a look at our rezoning once we've assessed it, create housing first projects so we can move people out of shelters, but also really to build the housing that's needed to try to get people off the streets. We looked at our Energy and Sustainability Committee. We're looking at modernizing our recycling program, putting up LED lights all throughout the city. This is both to try to reduce energy costs and to reduce our carbon footprint. Our Finance Committee, the City Council made a commitment. We do not want taxes to go up more than 2.5%. Now that may seem like a lot, but that would be the lowest increase we've had in 5 years and below the average for the last 10. It's not going to be easy, but that's what we asked the Finance Committee to look at. Another very important goal of the Finance Committee was looking at how do we pay for rebuilding our elementary schools. Hopefully we'll get a chance to talk about that a little bit more today, but our elementary schools are in desperate need of help. There's four of them, Lyseth, Presumpscot, Reike, and Hall. No, Hall's already done. Longfellow,
thank you.
And Longfellow, thank you, Ed. Those four elementary schools are in desperate need, and I'm probably gonna come to the chamber and ask for your help. I'm gonna come, you know, we often talk about how important education is, but it may cost us a little money to get there. And we may need to ask for your help in that, in supporting this publicly to see if people can make it happen. Because if we could reform our elementary schools, I think we'll really transform our city. You don't hear parents saying, I'm moving to Portland because you got the best schools in the state. We don't hear that yet. I want us to say that. I want parents to say before I'm done, I moved to Portland because you got the best schools in the state. And part of that is really making sure that we have the infrastructure that's in place. Our last committee, the HHS committee, we talked a lot about how do we move people finally from poverty into a life of stability. and we directed the committee to go out around the country, find programs that are moving people from welfare and into work. And so when you put all of those, there's a lot of great goals there. I would probably say the schools is one of my top priorities, but on the economic side, how can we really move to universal broadband? I think that would just transform our economy if we could. So.
Let's talk about the need to fix our elementary schools for a minute, because I do know this is a passion of yours, and
yep.
You just reiterated that right here. I also know that's probably not going to come with a very small price tag. Mm-hmm. So what have you thought about how we would go about raising money for that? Do you anticipate making the changes at once, piecemeal over time? And to follow up on your question about the chamber's role, how can we help?
You can't do it all at once. We're not going to be able to. It will probably cost to do what needs to be done $50 to $60 million. It will have to be bonded, and what we have to figure out is what can we pay for over time. But it can't be done all at once. It will have to be over 4 or 5 years if that can even happen. But what we need to do initially is to make the commitment. So if we can get to a place where we think there is an affordable way to put a bond out on the ballot, for instance, I will come to the chamber and I will ask you to support that, even if that means that property taxes have to go up in order to do it. Even if it means that every business in this room is going to have to pay whatever it is to help make that happen. I'm going to ask you to step up and help, because we all say education is important, and we've got to make the commitment. And I know we want to think that, well, we could just move it from this pot to that pot, but I don't really think we can do that. We can't decimate other programs simply because we want this one. We have to aspire to greatness. And if we're going to have people say, families say, we have the best schools in the state, you're going to have to help us get there. And so I'll probably be coming forward and asking, once Nick Mavadonis figures out, because he's the man, how to pay for this, we'll be coming to you to ask for your help.
Great. Let's talk about a chamber favorite, Complete Streets.
Yes, I hear that is your favorite.
Yes. I love this. So pretty much everyone in this room on their way to today's event has experienced some of the elements of our city's Complete Streets plan. And I know our members have voiced their concern over what they see taking place on the roads and across the city. And people are just confused and wondering where are the ideas coming from and who's behind these ideas. So could you talk a little bit to the city's interpretation of Complete Streets and whether there might be a movement to balance the needs of pedestrians, cyclists, and motorists?
Well, I think there is a balance. I think there is right now a balance to try to do that. I wasn't on the council when it was passed, but I'm very much a supporter of trying to figure out how our city can have a better balance. I think there is a lot of realization that we were probably skewed too far to the side of simply being car-based. And there are a lot of pedestrians in our city. We want people to use alternative transportation. We want people to bike. But that doesn't mean that we're going to shut down Congress Street and shut down Spring Street, and we have to try to figure out how to do it. We all are going to walk out front and see Spring Street and sort of bang our heads and say, what happened here? And we get that. And I think actually John Jennings did a very good job that sort of got put in place, and he was immediately like, okay, we need to make some changes. I think that's part of what is going to be good about John's leadership and city manager is he's willing, when something doesn't work, to just go in and fix it. It's not going to take a whole committee to get together, not going to go hide in a closet and pretend it's somebody else's fault. And I think the city council's in the same place, willing to just say, let's look at the problem. But I don't want us to retreat from trying to create a city that is good for cars and for bikers and for pedestrians, because I think that will make us a stronger city. It will make a more vibrant economy. It'll make people want to come here more. So that balance is key, but I think we are trying to shift to that balance. The execution of it is where we may not have been perfect on Spring Street. The bump outs were maybe a little big. I drove over that thing a couple of times on my scooter. I know it doesn't work, but that was the good thing. John picked up the phone, he called the DOT, said we need to move that thing back 8 feet, and it was moved back 8 feet, right? That's how government should work. I am a believer that government can do good work, and it frustrates me when we don't because it feeds those who believe that it can't. And I'm pleased that we're willing to adjust. Everybody who runs a business knows you're making adjustments every day. Every day you make mistakes, and the next day you try to fix them. That's the same for anybody.
So a follow-up question to that. As these changes are being addressed, is the city looking at the individual projects in silos, like High Street, High and State Street, Spring Street, Franklin Arterial, or are they looking at the collective impact of all of these changes?
trying to look at the collective impact. I mean, the issue with Spring Street, which keeps coming up, was we were trying to fit into the state's paving schedule. So we tried to fit into that schedule to make it happen. That's probably part of why some of the pieces went through in a way that maybe they shouldn't have, even if the overall goal of it I actually agree with, and I think in the end, Spring Street will be a lot better. But yes, they have to be looked at, no doubt, as we're looking at the entire city, whether it's two-way or whether it's Franklin arterial. What we can't be doing is just doing these little spot pieces. It's going to take a lot of investment, so we have to make sure we can pay for it as well.
I would like to turn our attention to what I would arguably say is one of the most precious assets our city has and one of the most underutilized, and that is the Main State Pier. Brief history lesson, 10 years ago, Portland recognized that the pier was falling apart, put out an RFP to those who were interested in redeveloping it. Proposals were taken in. There were two that were accepted, and ultimately it wasn't redeveloped. So now it's 10 years later. I'm just curious as to what your thoughts are as to how we can turn that asset into an economic engine for Portland.
Yeah, it's very disappointing that that's still sort of sitting fallow. We have the Ocean Terminal down there, which is half empty. This was one of the goals that the council brought up and actually received close to the high, I think it received 8 votes from the council. And that was simply to take a look at it and try to figure out, come up with an answer that we can all agree to. So I'm not coming to you with what the answer should be. I don't think that's how the conversation should occur. But the council directed our Economic Development Committee under the leadership of David Brennerman to take a look at it and figure out what is an answer that will work for the city best that we can all embrace. It is a remarkable asset from, you know, how deep the water is there, to the number of people who could be coming across, to the kind of marine economic development that we want. And we can't let it sit fallow. So there's a commitment this year for the council to really take a look at this and figure out what can we come up with. I'm not going to give you the answer today. We need to get in front of it. But what we know on the council is we want to stop being reactive. We want to be proactive. We want to try to engage in a process where we're saying to people, here's what we want. Come to us with your ways to try to make that happen, and then hopefully we'll be able to get that implemented. 10 years ago, we tried to do that, and unfortunately it fell through. Now hopefully we can do it a little differently.
That is good to hear. My follow-up question was going to be, should we be proactive, and should we decide what we think the best use is of the pier, as opposed to being reactive? And it sounds like yes. Are doing that,
yes,
which is great.
Sure.
Let's talk a little bit about growth of the city. We all know the stats about Maine having an aging and a slow-growing population. We need an influx of new people, hopefully educated and skilled people who can join our workforce to counter this. What strategies would you implement to attract people to our city to help reverse this negative trend?
There's a lot of things we need to do. We've talked a little bit about education, again, about parents wanting to be here because we've got the best schools. I mean, that really is such a driving force for young families, where they can put their kids in school. One of the things the council also brought up, which received almost universal support from the council, is creating some kind of Office of New Americans, recognizing that we have a lot of people who we are not utilizing right now, people who are coming to us who are the best and the brightest from all over the world, who can't break out of poverty because we are not doing enough to try to figure out how to channel them into our economy to build the next generation. You know, that is how Portland's been built for 200 years, and that's what we have to focus on. So some of it is we've got some of the resources here, but we sort of just don't want to see it, or we don't want to bring it into the community. So we just kind of create these, you know, segregate people out instead of figuring out how do we incorporate. So creating an Office of New Americans, I think, could really help us look at who it is we have in our community that we could be better utilizing. I think a lot of folks in the business community often do, right? You're trying to figure out when you meet somebody who, you know, comes from Sudan, who was the superintendent of a school district of 30,000 students, and they're here as, you know, and the only kind of job they can get is cleaning a hotel that, you know, barely pays them enough to be able to survive. You know, there's something wrong. Right, or people who have got medical degrees from other countries who we say you got to come back here and you're going to do another 10 years of medical school before you can practice. We know that's not the way that we're going to best build our economy, and perhaps an Office of New Americans could help us with that. I do think, you know, one of the things about Portland that also is very important is how vibrant we are. We have to make sure that our you know, that our climate in this city remains energized and that people want to be here. And the last piece around that I would say is USM. USM is so key to our future. Having a strong USM, having a strong college community is really, I mean, imagine what the city would be like without USM. We'd be decimated. But with USM and with a strong USM, we can really have the kind of mix that we need, I think, for the next generation.
With the Office of New Americans, or whatever the office may be called once it's formed, do you see a role for the chamber with the efforts coming out of that office, as well as the chamber potentially helping the immigrant and refugee community get better integrated into our workforce?
Sure, absolutely. I think in the Office of New Americans, I mean, again, the council has to decide what does this look like? How do we do this? There are models for it all over the country, but it's really about, we send it to the Economic Development Committee. It wasn't sent to the Social Services Committee. It was sent to the Economic Development Committee because we understood it was one of the top priorities for the Economic Development Committee, an Office of New Americans, because we understand that as our economic tool. So absolutely, the chamber needs to be involved in that conversation. And what is it? What are the kinds of workers that you need, and how can we figure out if we already have them and you just haven't been able to find them yet because they're buried somewhere where we don't understand what their qualifications are? You could also pay for it if you'd like. We'd always love that. You ready for that, Chris?
Chris Hall, have you duly noted? He's got that.
Yeah. Taxes?
Yeah. No, just a fee.
Oh, just a fee.
As we discuss the growth of Portland, we're forced to address one of the hottest topics that's afflicting our city, and that is of housing and the housing crunch. With vacancy rates near zero, it's becoming increasingly more difficult to find affordable housing. And I know that the City Council's Housing Committee has just recently met on this issue. But what do you hope to do to alleviate this problem?
Again, what I hope is that the council is able to come to some both very specific and hopefully ambitious goals. Councilor Dusan, who is chairing this, who has graciously agreed to chair this committee, what the council did is put together this housing committee, which has an unprecedented 5 members of the council. There are 9 of us. So what that means is this committee basically has the power it needs to put into place the changes that need to occur. It will have to come to the full council, but if this committee is unanimous, they don't need any of the rest of us. So it's a very powerful body. And there, and Jill, under Jill's leadership, they have begun the process of right now trying to gather information. Councilor Dusan's been very committed to saying, look, I want to start from the same place. Let's all get the same set of data so that we're not having these conversations and fighting about what it says or what it doesn't say. And once we get all of that data, then let's come to the place of let's getting all the ideas and hear them out and vet them together, and then hopefully be able to come to some conclusions and some real policy choices, both short-term and long-term, that can be sent to the council. And this is not, you know, like a 17-year committee. Right? Councilor Dusan, we're talking about getting to the place where we're fleshing out ideas by the 4th meeting. So 2 to 3 meetings of information gathering to make sure we're there, and then by the 4th meeting, which is basically in 2 months, start putting ideas on paper so that hopefully within 4 months we can actually get a package to the council, start moving some things to the council that can actually start to alleviate some of the problems. And it ran the gamut of what we have to do. Like I said, Housing First Projects is going to do a lot in terms of our shelters. Zoning is really a key. We're seeing this issue down with CVS, down on Forest Avenue. You know, it's interesting. There is a real pushback on that, and I'm pleased about that. I'm pleased that people are saying we don't need simply just another drugstore. We need housing. We need development that really helps us thrive as a city. And so we're looking at how do we do it. There may end up being some kind of drugstore there, but let's make sure there's housing above it. Or maybe there's a dorm for USM, or maybe there's some other kind of economic development added on top of it, because we have to look at zoning, we have to look at density, and that will be that'll be an absolute key to figuring out how we solve this. But we're going to run the gamut. I'm not coming into the committee saying, here are the policies I want us to put into place. I'm simply saying to the committee, find the best ideas and bring them to us.
So 2 follow-up questions, and I'm going to hope to not forget the second follow-up question. But okay. So we lack supply of housing. We need to incentivize new housing. How do you feel towards providing incentives to create more market-rate housing options?
Well, I mean, I think if you mean by zoning incentives, I think zoning is very important. Create better density. That would allow, I think, people to be able to build buildings perhaps higher with more units. And that's a very good incentive for folks on the market rate side. But I do want to say, and I know this is not, you know, going to be as orthodox in this room, I don't think the problem is simply supply and demand. There is a supply problem that has to be alleviated. But right now, what's happening is most of the supply that's getting built is market rate and not affordable for a lot of our middle class families. So we have to find a way to make sure that we're also building workforce housing. Inclusionary zoning passed. I know that was not your favorite policy, but it's going to do good. It's been put in place. We're just talking about 10% of new units that have to be built that are affordable for working class families. We cannot, the city cannot become like Boston, right? We cannot become a city of the uber wealthy and those who are looking for services if we don't protect the middle class and make sure that we incentivize housing into that middle. Because that's what Boston's become. And Portland was built by the middle class. Generations of the middle class have built this city. And it's still here. I mean, we're not going to become Boston in a year. But if we don't try to look at it and try to work with it, in 10 years we will. And so I think we really need to try to incentivize that middle class housing. So zoning is really probably your best place to be looking at that. But you do also sometimes have to put some restrictions in place. And that's why inclusionary zoning is a good idea.
So back to the Forest Ave development, the CVS development that you had brought up earlier. I know that the council was considering zoning changes for that parcel. Do you feel we are changing the rules again midstream for developers?
Well, there is no site plan in, so there's no, this is not something where somebody's already put a plan into place, right? There's just a conversation has begun around this. And so what's interesting about that piece is that it all got zoned, it's called B2B, which sort of incentivizes some density and housing. And this little piece got kind of left out. So there's some level that the council's kind of looking at and saying, well, wait a minute, how come that little piece got left out? It might have been because Oakhurst is across the street and because Hannaford is down, and so somehow this got included in something that shouldn't. So what we've asked the planning board to do is take a look at that and say, okay, why did that piece get left out? But I also think that we should always be looking. If we think something is about to happen in our city that we don't want to have happen, you should have a right to have a conversation about it. You have to have a right to say, we want to look at this because we're going to have to live with it for the next 50 years. I don't know what the planning board is going to do. I don't know what the city council is going to do. But I do think it was very important. I'm very glad that Councilor Ray brought it forward to simply say, hey, wait a minute. There's been a lot of outcry about this. Let's slow down. Let's take a look. But there is no proposal that's actually in place. So this is not as if a developer has put their thing, done all their plans, got it through, and then all of a sudden the carpet's being pulled out. We tried to get this in front of that happening for exactly those reasons.
So as I anticipated, time is going quickly. So I'm going to pick up the pace a little bit. In December, we had the Portland Police Chief here, as well as addiction specialist Dr. Cassells, to talk about our substance abuse epidemic that's plaguing the city. And the police chief will actually be a guest at the Chamber's board meeting on Monday to continue the conversation. We want to look for ways that the business community can help tackle this crisis. What do you think the Chamber should be doing in relation to the substance abuse epidemic?
I thought that was an incredible forum, by the way. I was glad to be here. It's not just the Chamber. It's all of us. All of us understanding that we aren't gonna change the dynamic around the heroin epidemic until we understand that addiction is a healthcare issue. It is not an enforcement issue. It is a healthcare issue. It is like a heart condition that has to be dealt with medically. And once we start to change that dynamic, it doesn't mean that enforcement isn't part of it. As the chief talked about, it's enforcement, it's in prevention, and then it's about treatment, right? It's that three-legged stool. But we focus so much on enforcement and not enough on prevention and treatment that we've kind of lost our balance. So until we start to understand it as a healthcare issue, I don't think we're ever going to turn it around. I do think, you know, somebody asked at the last one, you know, how many of you know a heroin addict or somebody who's used heroin? you probably know a lot more than you realize. You certainly, everybody in the room knows an addict, I would imagine. How many people here know an addict? Of any kind? Alcohol, cigarettes, drugs? It's a medical condition, all of them, and we have to make a decision that we're going to focus on it that way.
One of the issues that came to light during that presentation at Exit Issues is that a huge part of the battle we're facing with the substance abuse epidemic is the stigma that's associated with substance abuse. Do you feel you as mayor have a role in helping to educate the community and helping to do away with that stigma so that we can actually combat the crisis?
The stigma of substance abuse? Yeah, I mean, again, it's about healthcare. And, you know, we, in asking everybody to raise their hand and say, do you know somebody? Sometimes those people that you know who are addicts, you're really angry at, you're furious at, because they're tearing apart your family or really harming themselves and you're watching it. And so that creates a stigma, I get it. Some of you have recognized people go through recovery. I mean, I'm I don't know if you even call it a saint. I grew up in New York City in the 80s, right?
There'll be a follow-up question for that one.
You know, there isn't much out there I haven't tried. And that's, you know, that maybe that's part of whatever it is, but we all have to be compassionate and understanding. And I certainly have very close friends who weren't able to simply try it and fell down a very, very steep set of stairs. And it's painful to watch. And so we just all have to recognize that. So
let's talk about New York in the 80s.
Yeah.
We'll save that. Because
yeah.
I do really, I know we are running short on time, and there is another issue that I do think is very important that I would like to address with the mayor, and that is of education. So one of the biggest one of the biggest factors that families look at when deciding what community to call home is the quality of schools. And Portland faces the challenge of keeping families here as their kids enter the school system. Families often move to the suburbs for education reasons. First question for you, is it perception or reality that Portland schools are not as good as neighboring towns? And there's always the question, does it matter if it's perception or reality? And then follow up to that is, how do we elevate Portland schools so that families do stay in the city?
I think there's a lot more that's going on in Portland schools than we realize. I think we have a lot of remarkable programs, a lot of and Learning Works was always doing a tremendous amount of work, after school programs in our schools, the Culture Club, which I just got a great presentation on the other day about making sure that every kid in school goes to four cultural events at our top four cultural institutions in the city of Portland. I had no idea that existed, but it existed going on for 4 years. And that's phenomenal, right? Kids going to the opera, kids going to Portland Stage, going to the museum. That's remarkable. It's great stuff. So is there better stuff going on in our schools than we know? Yes, no doubt about it. But as you said, whether it's perception or reality, we still don't have families saying, I'm moving to Portland because you got the best schools in the state. So I think there is both, that our schools are doing better work than people realize, but parents are pretty astute customers. You know, parents are pretty astute customers. They look pretty closely at what they want for their kids. And we want them to be making the choice every day that this is the place they want to come and this is the place they want to stay. And I want to start hearing parents from Scarborough and from Falmouth saying, I'm moving to Portland because I want my kid in that school.
So the Chamber of Commerce is an advocacy organization. We advocate on behalf of our membership. And I am curious, as I'm sure many in the audience are, what advice do you have for us as to how we can do that better? How can we advocate for our membership better?
I would say so that's always a hard conversation to have, but if I were to be honest, what I would ask of the chamber, which is what I ask of most groups, is don't set your hair on fire every time. The issues that are coming before us sometimes are hard and they're complicated, but don't set your hair on fire every time. I'd say State Street and High Street. This is an issue, it's an important issue, I get it. I don't know that it's something that we all have to die on our sword over one way or the other. I'm not saying that you did or that you didn't, but sometimes that happens on both sides. I think we have to always be trying to figure out how do we have a dialogue to make this work better. We had a big minimum wage fight last year, obviously, in the council and then on the ballot. One other thing that I'm going to ask you to do, what was your main argument against the minimum wage going up last time? Anybody remember? What was it? Sorry, not, yes, that one, but what was your argument against the 1010? The argument against the 1010 that the chamber made was that it would make Portland an outlier, right? We would be higher than the surrounding communities. I'm going to ask you to take a hard look at yourselves when the $12 an hour is on the ballot, because the $12 an hour will solve that problem. It will make the state of Maine equal, and Portland will no longer be an outlier. So I'm going to ask you to be consistent in your arguments when that gets on the ballot to say, you know what? It will be good for Portland if the entire state goes to 12, because Portland will no longer be an outlier. That's kind of conversations I'm going to want to have all the time. Be honest brokers. When we're talking about stuff, don't try to spin stuff one way or the other. And don't catch your hair on fire on every issue. Maybe one or two, but not everyone.
It's wise advice. And part of the reason why we are here today is to establish what each of our goals and priorities are and determine where they line up. And I think this is just the first of many conversations to come. And I know we're past our time, but I have one final question for you. And probably I would say the most important question of the morning. 2016 World Series.
Yeah.
Mets versus Cubs. Mets fan, right?
Yeah. Cubs fan.
Yes.
Yeah.
Now who wins, Mets versus Cubs? And I will remind you that the Mets have won a World Series in the last 30 years against the Red Sox.
1986. I got a picture of Mookie running up to first base on my wall in the office. If anybody would like to come and see it.
I will also remind you that the Cubs basically have not won a World Series, or I'll say the radio wasn't even invented when the Cubs yes. won the last World Series. So I am building my support coalition for a 2016 Cubs World Series win. I'd like to invite you over to cheer for my lovable losers.
Well, it obviously can't be Mets Cubs because we're both National League teams, but if it were the Cubs, I would probably root for the Cubs. I would like the Cubs, but I'll be rooting for the Mets, though, in the National League Championship Series against your Cubs.
That hurts.
Yeah, it's all right.
Oh, and I will remind you that as the Cubs were on their way to the World Series, we got swept bad by the Mets last year. Great way to end this conversation. Well, this was fantastic, Mayor. I want to thank you so much for engaging in this dialogue. We do have a few minutes, and I would like to open it up to the audience if you have any questions for the mayor. There are microphones, which I can't really see, but they're usually right over here and here. If you could stand up to the mic, please say your name and the organization you represent before you pose your question to the mayor. That would be fantastic. We have one over here.
Hey, can you hear me?
Yeah.
I'm Chris. I'm representing the University of Southern Maine, but also students in recovery. I'm glad to hear the substance abuse issue being addressed today. And I just have a more specific question. We are a community that is plagued by overdoses and death as a direct result of the opiate crisis. And currently, police officers are not required to carry naloxone. This is a proven way to save the lives of the men and women whose misuse of substances has put them in a life-threatening situation. Having this life-saving drug in the hands of the men and women who are tasked with keeping our community safe is imperative. Would you be willing to make sure that police officers, both full-time and part-time, are required to carry naloxone and have the training to properly administer it?
I don't know enough. Is this a state issue or is this a local ordinance issue? Do you know, Ed? It's a local policy issue. I don't know enough about it right off the top of my head, but I am certainly in support of our police officers trying to have whatever tools they need to keep people alive. I'm sure our police officers are as well. So I'll take a look at it more closely. Thank you for bringing it up.
Thank you.
Hi, Mayor. I don't know if I should say I'm representing the University of Southern Maine, even though I'm a student there, but as a small business person and a person of color, I heard you give an eloquent use of why the term from away, but I hear you say you're starting the Office of New Mainers. don't you see the term New Mainers as being just as exclusive? There's a lot of old Mainers here who are not shifty and D-knowledge or whatever it is, who are business people and are looking to be included in this economy here and help this economy grow, and hardworking people and civic members.
Yeah, I do. I think there's room for both. I think it's important that we recognize where we have deficits and try to focus resources into those areas. I think we have a severe deficit in terms of our being able to utilize New Mainers who are coming here, new Americans from all over the world, some of the best and the brightest. That doesn't mean we don't also have issues around trying to make sure folks who are already here are being maximized as well. And we have to continue to put resources in that. But part of what we have to do is put a spotlight on areas where those deficits perhaps are deepest. And I think we have a tremendous opportunity missed that we aren't doing more within that community. But that I don't think putting a high spotlight on that means that we're in any way, shape, or form being exclusive of other communities. Thank you for the question.
Good morning, Mr. Mayor. My name is Ed Suslovic. I represent District 3 in the city. Key, very important question for you, Mr. Mayor. Tony's Donuts or the Holy Donut?
Oh, come on. It's got to be. Look, you know, I can spend $3 for a dozen at Tony's, or I can spend 36 at a Holy Donut. So. Holy Donuts donuts are great, though, let me just say. So they're awesome. I can't choose. How do I do that? Love them both. Love them both. My stomach doesn't, but... or my abs, I should say, don't.
Jamie Willie, I'm with Canteen Service, but I'm a Portland resident, and I can't believe I'm asking this question because I know some people who kind of are part of this, and I didn't know if there was a line that's crossed in your or the council's mind. The Airbnbs and the renting out of people's houses and whatnot, I'm not sure if there's a line in your mind and the council's mind that gets crossed before some measures are taken. I saw in today's paper there was a college student renting out their dorm room, and to me, I mean, that's a line that's crossed, right? But but there's a part of me too that thinks that it's okay for people to benefit to a certain degree. But from a policy and an execution standpoint, whether there's a line in your mind that's crossed before something is done.
It's obviously a complicated issue. You know, the council has looked at this issue. I've talked to a number of councilors about it. You know, the stories you hear about some families who are able to rent out a room in their place to help pay their property taxes or for somebody to help be able to pay their rent. So. Those kinds of things, you understand. It's unfortunate that people aren't earning enough money to be able to do it otherwise. But we always have to be taking a look. I don't know that it's a problem yet, but I do know that there are in a number of cities where what you've seen is that landlords have basically emptied out residential buildings and turned them basically into hotels. And that could contribute greatly to our housing problem if we aren't careful. I don't think at the moment we're there, but I do think we have to monitor it pretty closely to figure out. We got 17,000 apartments in the city of Portland. You know, if we lose 2,000 of those that are no longer apartments and become basically hotels, hostels, whatever you want to say, that will contribute, and we'll probably have to do something. So,
Mayor, I'm John Andrew from Oxford Networks. Thank you for coming and speaking. My question's on education, but I want to start by saying real quick. Just 2 years ago, I taught my mother, who's in her early 60s, how to use something that some of you may know of called YouTube. And she's a great cook, and on her vacation, she spent hours learning new meals that she had never learned before, and now cooks healthier. And my father was watching reruns on the History Channel. We now know Facebook, Twitter. We're now all able to Google topics that hitherto we didn't know so much about. And we're more aware from social media on many different topics. My question is, how do you think technology can be a benefit for education?
Oh boy, it's right now it's a cornerstone. As we're looking at our new schools, new hall school, and trying to make sure that it's got the technology it needs, but I'll just tell you a little story, even at LearningWorks. We brought in Jeannie Wynot-Vickers, who came in, and we used to be the superintendent of Portland schools, and She walked in after about a week. I said to her, I'd like you to assess my education programs and see what we need to do. She walked into the classroom within like 48 hours. She came in my office and said, I don't need to see any more. You got students who are doing worksheets. You know, they're working on paper and pencils. You're giving these at-risk kids the second-class education that's kept them in the place that they're in. And within about 3 months, we had raised the $100,000 we needed to put smart boards in every classroom to make sure every student had a laptop, every student had access after school to whatever kind of internet needs, and you could start to see the results. Our graduation rates got so much higher. The jobs they were getting into were so much better. So it's technology, like universal broadband for the city. You know, it's like what highways used to be or what electricity was back in the 30s or, you know, across the board. It's the new infrastructure that we need, airports, in order for our economy to grow, and it's key for education.
Hi, my name is Zoe Salul. I'm the executive director for New England Arab American Organization. It's a new nonprofit organization. My question for you, is there an incentive given to businesses in Portland to employ or utilize the new immigrants and refugees' skills so they can employ them? Instead, like you mentioned, let's say a superintendent working as a person who cleans the hotels. Is there an incentive maybe to utilize better these skills?
I don't know the answer to that at the moment. Okay. I don't know the answer, but let me see if I can find out. Okay. If you're talking about like some kind of specific tax credit, I don't believe that there is, but the state has some programs around who you're hiring or what part of the state that you might work in, whether you might get some kind of credit on income tax or a piece like that, but I don't know at the local level if we have anything like that in place.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Eamon Dundon. I'm a senior at Portland High School. And generally, I've been very impressed with the relationship that you and Mr. Jennings have and the work you guys have been doing. But one place I feel that might have fallen short, and maybe it's just a matter of poor communication, was around this new mayoral assistant position that's been proposed, or speechwriter, however you want to put it. And I'm wondering what you see as the need there, and does it really deserve the salary that's been proposed, and why has there been sort of poor communication around this position? Thank you.
Yeah, there was certainly poor communication around it. Maybe if I'd had a speechwriter, I'd have been able to do better communication around it. Yeah, there's no doubt. I mean, I think anybody who works in the private sector, you understand that in order to accomplish what you have to get done, you have to have support. You have to have people around you to do it. I was a CEO, obviously, for a company in 19 years, and you've got to have people who work for you that are able to help execute what it is that you want to accomplish. And this is just a piece of that. The city manager and I agreed on this. The first day I walked in, both he and the city manager before, Sheila, had given a memo to the council saying the mayor has got to have better support. You represent 65,000 people. You know, there's more staff support, direct staff support for a member of the state House of Representatives than there is for a mayor who represents 65,000 people. So yes, there's no doubt there has to be some staff in place in order to do this job right, or don't have the job. I mean, that's sort of this conversation that we're having. Either do it and do it right, or don't do it. But at the moment, the people have said, we want this job, we want this job to be successful, and I'm not willing to do it for 4 years and not be successful. I don't think you should, you know, pay me $70,000 if I'm not going to be successful. So I want to make sure that I have the support in place to both do what it is that the council wants to accomplish, very ambitious goals, trying to have somebody to help shepherd those through, but also simply to be able to respond to all the needs that come in every day. Every meeting I have, there's got to be follow-up, it's got to be work done. So I think most people in the private sector understand you got to have support in order to accomplish your tasks. So. But thank you.
One more question.
Thank you. I guess that's me. Rick Snowman, indoor karting. And one of the things that I want to bring up, and I really applaud you and all that you're doing, my ancestors, and I've been known from being away as well, but when they built Portland, it was built by a group of entrepreneurs that sat around and they fixed things. They got things done. And there was an entrepreneurial spirit that we're seeing regenerated. And I want to make sure that you, as the mayor and as the town, understand that not all things can be fixed through public service, and we as entrepreneurs can fix things if we're given the ability and the opportunity to just get it done. And a lot of things that happen out of City Hall or out of Augusta or out of Washington prevent us from doing that. And so when you're thinking about this, think of us as a partnership, but also understand that not everything can be fixed at City Hall, and that we can fix things if we're given that opportunity. So instead of restricting our abilities, kind of open it up and say, yeah, let's get entrepreneurship back into the process.
Yeah, I'm with you. It's absolutely a two-way street. I'd ask the same in the other direction as well. I think one of the areas that we really recognize on the government side that we are not doing enough to help you do exactly what you're talking about is around our planning and permitting process. Our city manager is putting in place what we think could be a true transformation of that work, and so that hopefully that will allow us to be much better at being able to make sure you can get your permit instead of taking you 3 months, can take you 3 days. That kind of way, I think, will help the private sector to thrive. So I agree with you. We should always be checking each other on those things, so please let me know when we're getting in the way, and I'll let you know when we maybe need to be a little more in the way. So.
Thank you very much for the questions. Thank you, Mayor Strimling.
And thank you for not asking what I ingested in the 80s.
Follow-up that will come later. But in all seriousness, I appreciate your time and your interest. As I said, this is just the start of many conversations to come. As a thank you for today, we'll be making a donation in your name to the Boys and Girls Club. So thank you for being here. And I hope you join us next month. I think March 3rd, we have Janine Carey from the Maine International Trade Center will be here. There's lots going on with the Maine International Trade Center, not the least of which is the shipping channels through the Arctic Circle. So she'll have much to report on. I hope you will join us then. Thank you for being here and have a great day.